actor Forrest Tennant is. He started his pain practice back in 1975, and it originally focused on treating pain of cancer and post-polio. Since then, he's authored over 300 scientific articles and books, and he formerly served as a medical officer in the U.S. Army and the U.S. Public Health Service, and in the past has been a consultant to the FDA, the National Institute on Drug Abuse, the DEA, the LA Dodgers, how fun, the NFL, and NASCAR. He has a wide array of experience with chronic pain, and tonight he's here to talk to us about arachnoiditis. So thank you so much for being here, and let's get started.
Okay, thank you.
First, can you let everybody know what arachnoiditis is?
I certainly will. It's a very misunderstood term to start with. The arachnoid is the covering of the spinal cord. The name that people are most familiar with will be the dura or dura mater or the theca, but the arachnoid is the middle layer of the covering of the spinal cord. It's not the spinal cord. It's not the nerve roots. It's the covering of the spinal canal. Now, the spinal canal is filled with fluid. And so this covering keeps the fluid in and makes it a pipe fundamentally. So the spinal canal is fundamentally a pipe. Now the word itis means inflammation. So the simple definition of arachnoiditis is inflammation of the covering of the spinal cord. And the reason why it's so topical today is that its prevalence is increasing greatly. And it's and we have the technology to diagnose it today when, as recently as a couple of years ago, we didn't have much in the way of diagnostic technology. But again, it means an inflammation of the covering of the spinal cord.
Great. And does the arachnoiditis travel through the whole dura? Can it be in any part of the spine?
Yes. Now, the vast majority of cases, 95%, are in the lumbar sacral area. It's in the lower spine. Now, the reason it's in the lower spine is, first off, that's where we humans like to traumatize ourselves, and that's where all our weight happens to be, is in the lumbar area. But more important, the spinal cord actually only comes down to about the middle of your back. Now, below the spinal cord, below the middle of your back, is really not a cord, but it's about two dozen little strings known as nerve roots, and collectively they are called the cauda equina. A cauda equina in Latin and Greek means horse's tail. So starting at about the middle of your back, you have about two dozen small little string-like nerve roots that hang down. Now, these nerve roots hang down suspended in fluid, and if they get inflamed, they get compressed, they get diseased. If anything happens to them, they can become inflamed, and then after a while, they can form scarring and adhesions, and the adhesions may stick into the lining. And when those nerve roots stick to the lining, it's called adhesive arachnoiditis. And that is the devil's own disease. That is a condition in which, frankly, no one should have, because it is not only painful, it has all kinds of disabling complications. And when one gets this, their life changes immediately, because it is one of the most, one or the two most painful diseases known to man.
Who's susceptible to getting arachnoiditis or adhesive arachnoiditis?
It used to be thought that the only way you got arachnoiditis was to have the covering punctured somehow. And a lot of your early cases are on where surgeons would nick the or cut the dura, or there was trauma, for example, or a spinal tap was infected. Over 100 years ago, the common causes were syphilis and tuberculosis, but those have long since disappeared. But what really causes the problem today is this. If you have a common spine problem, such as chronic slip disc, scoliosis, spinal stenosis, arthritis, rheumatoid spondylitis, if you have a common spine problem and you carry it long enough, you're going to put either compression or friction or some rubbing together of those fine nerve roots and causing inflammation, and that sets it off. Now, if a person has surgery or has an epidural injections or something, or a spinal tap, you may accelerate the process. But the process begins with the common spine conditions known to all of us. And this is the problem today, is that people are living longer, they're having lots of procedures, people are overweight, they don't exercise much, they're sedentary, and so we have the prevalence of arachnoiditis going up several hundred fold in the past 10 years, and it looks like it continues to go up. Most of the cases that we used to call failed back syndromes or chronic back syndromes, degenerative back syndromes, most of these cases, or a great percentage of them, are really arachnoiditis. And now that we can diagnose it with an MRI and with blood tests and a physical exam, we're now finding out how common it really is and how disabling it really is.
Wow. Is there any way to slow down the progression of arachnoiditis or the symptoms that it causes?
Yes. Now, it's a very important question you ask, because physicians, nurse practitioners, chiropractors, osteopaths see back pain patients every day in their practice. And it's important that medical professionals know which ones of these cases may have arachnoiditis. Now, first of all, when you develop arachnoiditis, particularly adhesive arachnoiditis, you're going to have constant pain. Secondly, the cardinal symptom is you can't sit or stand in one place very long. The third one is you almost always develop some bladder problems. You can't either start your stream or get it stopped, or you may have some gurgling or some incontinence. Another common symptom is the feet burn. And it might surprise you, but one of these patients commonly get is blurred vision and poor balance. And so, again, a patient with chronic back pain who has trouble with the bladder and can't sit or stand in one position very long, and who has burning feet or who has blurred vision, these are the high suspects. In fact, if you have four out of the five symptoms I just told you about, chances are you have arachnoiditis. Now, particularly if you have a history where you've had some spine surgery, you had a cyst, you had epidural injections, that just makes it all the more probable that you may have arachnoiditis.
Okay, if a person has an MRI with contrast that shows minimal nerve clumping, is there a way that it can be reversed in the pain in the legs and spine?
Yes, it's an excellent question. I like to divide arachnoiditis into four categories. One is mild, the second is moderate, the third is severe, and the fourth is catastrophic. Now, those patients who may just have some clumping on their MRI, mm-hmm. and where they have some inflammation, but they haven't formed adhesions yet, or their bladder hasn't been impaired, or their legs impaired, those are the mild cases, and some of those resolve. They just totally resolve, just like any other kind of trauma or cut or scar or surgery. Resolution does occur. Now, once you get into the moderate, severe, and catastrophic categories, at this time, we do not talk in terms of resolution or cure. We have patients who have now been on some of the new treatment protocols for 4 or 5 years, which have achieved pretty much a near cure, but at this point, it is intractable and is non-curable unless you happen to be one of those lucky people who have the mild forms that's detected quite early and treated quite early.
Are these stages that you're saying, like, is mild?
They can be. In fact, they often are. The real danger of arachnoiditis is this. It is a progressive disease.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know when it's going to progress, or you don't know the rate of progression. Now, when I say progressive, here is what I'm getting at. You may start off with a fairly moderate case, but all of a sudden, within a week's period of time, you might become half paralyzed, both in your legs and possibly the arms. Your stomach and your bowel may start not working. Your bladder may not start working. You may get to where you can't sit at all, and you may have severe headaches. You may also then develop an autoimmune disorder because the inflammation inside the spinal canal can get into the general circulation, and then the next thing you know, you've got a generalized autoimmune disorder like lupus or rheumatoid arthritis. So the progression can be horrendous, and it can be fast. If people don't get the right help, they can end up in wheelchairs, or they can be bedbound. And, of course, you can die of this disease because the pain and the disability is such that it drains your adrenal gland and pituitary gland and your immune system, so you end up getting an infection and dying. And so it can be catastrophic. But the big problem is the progression, and you just don't quite know when the progression will occur. We can do tests today, and after a while, I've learned that I can look at the MRIs and tell whether it's probably going to be progressive or not, but that's not 100%. But we can take blood tests now for inflammatory markers and get some idea how bad the inflammation happens to be, and that also gives us a clue as to how vigorous the condition should be treated.
Is there any correlation between adhesive arachnoiditis and multiple sclerosis?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that? I didn't quite hear the last term.
Yeah, multiple sclerosis. Is there any correlation between, you're saying lupus and you named a couple of other diseases. Is there any correlation between?
Not that I know of. At this time, I don't know of any cases of multiple sclerosis that have developed arachnoiditis.
Okay.
I can see that it could happen, but it is just simply not something that occurs. I've reviewed a few hundred cases here in the last year, and there have been no cases of multiple sclerosis.
Okay, and then what are the main differences between arachnoiditis, and I'm probably going to get this wrong, CES, Claudia Equina Syndrome?
Claudia Equina Syndrome, yes.
Yes.
Now,
do most patients have both?
Well, you do. By definition, you almost do. Now, the best way to explain that is this. A few years ago, particularly emergency rooms and neurosurgeons and orthopedists would teach and practice and be very aware of what we call acute Cotta Equina Syndrome. Now, that was when you usually had trauma, like I say, in the most common with some of an automobile accident or some other industrial injury, to where the spinal cord collapsed in on the cord or on the nerve roots or on the cauda equina, and therefore you couldn't walk and you couldn't urinate, you were in severe pain, and you were becoming paralyzed from about the umbilicus or stump belly button downward. And in those cases, there was immediate urgent surgery was required to decompress the whole spine. Otherwise, the patient became paralyzed. Now, in recent years, before the contrast and diagnostics got really good, you could see on the MRI where some of the cauda-equina nerve roots were clumped, and they had some bladder problems, perhaps some weakness of the legs, some headaches. And so some physicians have used the term chronic cauda-equina syndrome, and that's appropriate if you look at the MRI and see clumping in the nerve roots but no adhesions to the arachnoid. But once you have the adhesions sticking or gluing the nerve roots to the lining, the appropriate term for that is adhesive arachnoiditis. But it's certainly permissible to use the term chronic cauda equina syndrome, but that condition will likely go on to progress to adhesive arachnoiditis. So you can't take it lightly.
Thank you. Now can we turn to diagnosing arachnoiditis. What types of things can be, you named a few already, specific blood tests are doctors supposed to be looking at, and what other types of
I like to teach physicians and nurse practitioners to diagnose in a standard medical way. First of all, the patient's going to have a history. They're going to have a history of having back troubles, surgery, trauma, something to their back and where they've developed back pain. And the back pain is going to be rather severe. It's not going to be some mild pain in which Motrin's going to take care of it, or a little exercise or massage or chiropractic. Brachioiditis doesn't respond to those normal, standard, simple treatments. The pain's going to be much worse. Now, so you've got that history, and as I pointed out, some of the other symptoms a while ago. However, when the physician does a physical examination, you can find neurologic deficits of the legs and perhaps of the arms, and you'll also see some findings on the back. When you examine the back, there'll be certain indicators such as indentation of the skin, asymmetry of muscle groups, leaning, that type of thing, and reflexes will be off. So you get some physical signs. And then blood test-wise, the main thing is that you will see inflammation in the blood serum. And the simple tests are what's called a C-reactive protein or erythrocyte sedimentation rate. There's some fancier tests these days called interleukins or tumor necrosis factor, and those are starting to be offered to physicians just for the problem we're talking about. It helps us diagnose neuroinflammation, in other words, inflammation inside the brain or inside the spinal canal. And then the confirmation of the diagnosis is a contrast MRI, magnetic resonance imaging study. And once you get the history, the physical findings, the blood work, and then you see it on the MRI, the diagnosis is confirmed. It is made. And once it is made, it is my urge to everyone who hears this, you've got to have treatment. They used to say treatment was a hopeless situation. That's not true anymore. New protocols have been developed for centralized pain, neuroinflammation, and specifically for arachnoiditis.
Great. Can you see arachnoiditis on a myelogram?
The myelograms have in the past, depending on what dye was used, has been one of the causes of arachnoiditis. When I started seeing my first cases many, many years ago, they used a dye in the x-rays called Petapic. That was used in the myelograms. It was called Petapic, and that dye was toxic. Now, the MRI was invented in 1987, and since that time, dyes have been non-toxic, and now they even have some MRIs in which no dyes have to be used to get contrast. So the technology continues to improve, and once you know what one is looking at, it's very easy to see the arachnoiditis on the MRIs. It's my goal to hopefully to teach some doctors who want to subspecialize in treating this condition to learn how to look at the MRI just like I can. And it's not hard. It just takes a little time and doing. If I had the time, I could teach a fifth grader to look at the MRIs. When you learn what you're looking at, it's very clear what the MRI shows.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you think that a MR neurography imaging would actually show better than an MRI?
It could be. I don't know enough about it as of yet to know whether that's the case. But certainly the MRIs, in the various views that are now done, certainly seem to be adequate, particularly because you're not going to use the MRI as the primary diagnostic tool. That's there to be used to confirm the diagnosis after you have a history, physical findings, and laboratory findings that are compatible with the diagnosis. Okay. Incidentally, this is quite important because people want to get life or disability with a condition like arachnoiditis, and I can't blame them. They certainly are entitled to it in most cases. However, people think that a simple MRI is going to get them disability or going to get them a pension or get them some kind of benefits. It has to be done on a medical basis to where you have the history, the physical exam, laboratory test, and then the MRI. And we have enough tools right now to diagnose it many times over what we could, let's say, even 5 or 8 years ago.
Absolutely. Very important. So some of the causes of arachnoiditis you mentioned earlier, but can it be caused by any trauma to the spinal cord or the, I mean, when I met with you in person, you taught me that the fluid inside the spinal cord column could be drained or emptied with a trauma that doesn't necessarily break the arachnoid on the outside of the spinal cord, and you end up with...
That is correct. That is correct. In other words, people, for example, that have been in automobile accidents or industrial accidents or sports accidents, if they just have a good blow to their lumbar spine or sacral spine, they can put enough compression on the nerve roots because of swelling and bruising and bleeding to set up arachnoiditis and never actually rupture the dura or the whole covering. And so this does occur.